I'm Rohan Connolly, with me is my co-host Mark Fine, and we're going to unpick the complexities of a big round of football just like we would an IKEA purchase. We'll carefully sort through every item of AFL action, putting all the important pieces together before right at the end we realise we've got one left over, just chucking it away like it never existed and hoping like hell the whole thing doesn't fall apart. We've got the latest news with John Pierik. Your old favourite Stars in Cars is back. We're here for your questions, comments and slag-offs. We'll decide whether your team has credibility or is a footballing version of Nickelback before we launch a torrent of invective so intimidating it'd make Barry Hall run home to his mum. So let the frenzy of football fulmination begin as I say a very good afternoon to you, Finey, and ask whether, like the rest of us, you've had trouble sleeping knowing that Eddie Maguire might one day not be Collingwood president.
I've actually slept peacefully for the first time in years, having heard that.
Why?
Well, I'm sort of sick of the monthly Eddie-ism that...
Monthly?
You know, the things...
I thought it was hourly.
Well, the things he comes up with, the MCG area, the precinct being redeveloped, that was such a good idea. And that was a great idea, really, to build a smaller version of the MCG right next to the MCG. And then another one and another one, and have the first Russian doll set of stadiums in the world that could be folded into each other for storage. There was also his idea of allowing the winner of the NAB Challenge to go straight into the finals. Well, now we know why he did that.
Well,
because Collingwood were given the NAB Challenge and they ain't making the finals.
I think you're far too cynical. I think he's worth at least 5.5 goals per game to them. He's across the coaching plan too. He reckons they've got the right game plan. They've just been using the wrong players for it. So now Bucks knows that. They'll be set this week.
And there's nothing quite like, you know, you've really beaten them and it hurts them when he glowers. You know that when they showed that shot of him and his boys, he's explaining something to the young Maguires and he glowers as the team walks back off the field. Then you know you've had a good win against Collingwood.
Well, I reckon they wear the pants, the boys, because they talked him into staying on as president.
Yeah, it's always somebody else with Eddie. But look, he's in reality, he's been great for the club. He took them over when they were pretty well broke. He's got them in the red. Made a mistake with Malthouse and Buckley.
And that's what we do when we criticise Ed. There's always a few desperate seconds of sucking up at the end.
Well, there has to be because he's got a lot of media interest.
Yes.
Does he own Channel 31?
I don't know. But hopefully he's tuning in. G'day, Ed. We didn't mean any of it. Well, we had plenty of drama in round 7. Rivalries revived, scores settled, miseries multiplied, angst over umpires, and some other couplet that wouldn't come to me when I wrote this script. So let's have a look back on it all in Hot or Not. Okay, I'm kicking us off today, Finey, and I'm starting with the team that actually defeated Eddie's side, the Blues, and one man in particular, Levi Casbolt. I reckon he is a potential star. He wears a lot of flack about his kicking, which actually improved last year. It's been a bit dodgy, admittedly, early this season. But he was a tower of strength for the Blues on Saturday, and we'll see some examples here.
So he kicked one from the goal square, another one from...
But he kicked the clutch goal, Finey.
Yeah, but it was outside 50.
Hang on. Halfway through the last quarter, game's on the line, Collingwood looking threatening. Levi, the man, kicks it from outside 50.
They don't count. It's the outside 50s, they're not a problem. They never were for bad kicks. The goal square's not the problem, it's a 30-metre, 140-degree angle. Look, That's the trouble.
He took 11 marks, he's one of the best contested marks in the game. I think he'll just get better and better. I think he's a long-term key forward for the Blues. Big thumbs up to Levi.
He's got the best hands in footy. So he's a very good player.
Yeah, you've done the backtrack again.
No, not on his kicking.
Turned into John Ralph, back up the truck fine.
What does a 30-metre kick have to do with good hands? Oh, you don't kick it with your hands.
Your go.
Okay, I'm going to stick with the Blues, and Andres Everett is hot.
It's a Carlton festival.
Andres Everett was completely ignored in the first few weeks of Brendan Bolton's tenure, and I just thought, well, he's moved on. He's taken these GWS boys ahead of him. He came out, he had over 25 possessions, kicked a couple of goals, and then in the last quarter made two terrible errors, and I thought this is going to have a terrible ending for Andres, but he actually lifted again and contributed in the last few minutes. He's not a bad player, can play a variety of positions, and of course he comes from the great Everett family, which has played over, I think it's 6 clubs over 2 decades. And I mean that, you know, he started when his brother finished.
So it's how big's the age gap between Peter and Andre?
I used to maliciously, when still at the animal enclosure, when Andre started playing, saying, your dad used to play for St Kilda, but they definitely are brothers. And we've had an Everett play footy for 25 years or something.
It's amazing.
It is amazing.
They might be the next Fletcher dynasty. Okay, I'm up next. Next one's a knot. And unusual to say this, but my knot goes to Gary Ablett. Now, it's an example of how high a bar he sets, that he's averaging 27.4 possessions per game this season, and we're asking about what's wrong with him. But there you go. There's a good example. I've written about this in The Age today, and an opposition analyst said to me, they can't remember him being caught with the ball as much as he has this season. He's really lost his explosiveness out of the stoppages. Some speculation that he's been carrying a range of injuries, calf, knee, I think the other one might have been ankle. But just talking to a few people at the club, they're just wondering whether more of it's psychological. He's always had a bit of an issue playing with pain. He doesn't sort of withstand it as well as some. Discomfort, everything needs to be 100%. The other area, interestingly, where people think he's being exposed is his defensive running. He's never been a great defensive runner, but when he's tagged every week, it sort of masks the issue a bit because he's always got a guy by his side. What's happened lately is they haven't been tagging him as tightly, and he's being exposed. And when they had that honesty session the other week, I'm told his teammates didn't hold back. Even some of the junior guys were saying, Gaz, you've got to get back to it. He said himself after the game on Saturday, I've got to get back to hunting the ball. I hope he's brought his hunting gear with him on the weekend because they need him desperately.
So at the start of the season, a lot of people said this year will sort out who the best player in the AFL is, Fife or Ablett. Fife's out for most of the season.
That's a little draw.
Ablett, not really in great form. Dangerfield probably holds the crown at the moment, doesn't he?
Yeah, I think so. You're up.
What's not hot is Adelaide's draw, but they are hot. Look, Adelaide have had a really good start to the season, and we talk about the close squeaks for Hawthorn and them getting through at 5-2. Adelaide's been bloody unlucky. They played North at Etihad Stadium, just got beaten. Hawthorn at the MCG, just got beaten. Dogs at Etihad. Now, you know those games were not written in stone at those stadiums each year. If they would have played, I really believe this, North at the G, I think they would have won. If they played Hawthorn at Etihad, I think they would have won, because Hawthorn are a better team at the G. And the Doggies were playing their seventh in a row at the bloody ground. If they could have got them at the G, I think they could have won. I'm not talking about playing these games in Adelaide. They were played at the wrong grounds in Melbourne for North Melbourne.
No, they're
for Adelaide.
Quality side, the Crows.
And, I know you like them. I know you like them. But they could have easily been almost undefeated.
Yep. No, I agree. We'll rip through the last two. I've got a hot to finish off. And it's Stephen Motlop down at Geelong. Fantastic game for them against the Cats. Kicked four goals, had 25 possessions, gave one away to Tommy Hawkins. But I just think a really significant performance. We know Selwood and Dangerfield are terrific for them. I reckon the one quality they've perhaps been a bit questionable in is that explosiveness. Now, this guy has it in spades. Might sound like a bit of a stretch, but I think his performance could be the one that determines whether they're capable of actually winning a flag or not. So, big hot.
And you like a cockatoo that plays for them?
I do. He's terrific.
Yeah. Nakaya.
Okay. Is that your ostentatious impersonation, was it?
No, just an observation.
Finish off quickly.
Can I do non-footy?
Yeah, quickly.
Did you see Leicester City celebrate their magnificent win in the English Premier League?
I got up for it, mate. 2:30. The Foxes. Go.
The greatest singers of all time, Andre's Big Shelley. The man that David Schwartz, by the way, had a crack at for wearing dark sunglasses to a performance. He had a mixed day. He was hot here singing Nessun Dorma, I think from Turandot by Puccini. You told me that before the show, of course.
Puccini. I thought he was a virtuoso guitarist, Puccini.
Yeah.
I was Satriani, so go on.
But he had a great day to start off with. He had a very busy day because after this, he went and refereed the game between West Ham and Swansea. That Swansea won 4-1, and quite frankly, he should stick to singing.
Are you forever blowing bubbles, Finey?
We blew that game, and unfortunately, might not go to Europe. We'll find out tomorrow.
We'll be back with Soccerology. No, time for a short break. When we come back, our news hound's going to pick the eyes out of all the latest news, chuck in liberal use of words like...
Did you just say pick the eyes on the back of the...
Oh, sorry, bad analogy. Chuck in liberal use of words like breaking, exclusive and latest developments and just about convince you that it's really important. But let's go to the coaches' press conferences first, where our man Grant Dickinson has been putting all those other media hacks to shame, ignoring the obvious and instead asking the pressing question.
Don, you wore those yellow jumpers against the Bulldogs tonight, and Tom sitting here looks devastated it's clashed with his red hair. What are you going to do about that sort of stuff? Are you going to wear them again? Or?
Oh, look, that's something we'll look at on review.
Welcome back to the show with a big welcome and congratulations to John Pierik, who on Sunday night took out the Logie for Best Dressed Footyology Panellist, which as you'd imagine saw him up against some pretty stiff competition. Put on your best dramatic pose. It's time for tomorrow's news today. G'day JP, well done. What can I say? Must have the night of nights.
It's been a big 48 hours, Rohan. I'm yet to get home, so hi to the family if they're tuning in.
Well, I mean, you're being silly.
No,
we could have easily won a Logie.
For what?
The only best footy set? Show with a name that has Logie in it. Footy-O-Logie.
Very good, very good. How was the after party, by the way? Were you the guy that knocked out? Whose brother got knocked out again? Oh, Lauren Phillips.
Didn't happen to see that, but I've just been trying to get some sleep in a corner somewhere for the last 24, 48
hours.
Okay,
well, you know, press on, do your best. What do you
so
got
I don't
for
have
us?
The greatest list this week.
Come on, you can do it.
Let's start at Geelong, where Mitch Clark was going to be one of the key players for the Cats this year. Unfortunately, he's had calf injuries. First sustained this in January, and then again in March, it's re-flared. There were reports he was going to return this week, but the Cats have told Footyology he won't be back until next month now. He's training well. As we know, he's been fighting depression as well, but all is okay on that front, the Cats say. But he's been a big loss, hasn't he, not playing for him? He's going to be the perfect fall for Tom Hawkins up forward.
He's almost a forgotten man, and I guess in a way, particularly recently, his role's sort of been supplanted by Shane Kirsten. I know Chris Scott really rates Shane Kirsten, and he's been a bit up and down, but just the last few weeks, I reckon he and Hawkins have really developed a good combination.
I was going to say, if Clark was available this week, it would be a sort of difficult selection balancing act. There's a spot for him in the team, but I was going to make that point. The Kirsten and Hawkins finally fired on the same afternoon.
It's a really interesting selection poser for him when he does come back,
and
though,
Stanley.
Because
they've
got plenty of new players coming in. Scott's talked repeatedly about, you know, it takes some time to get all these guys to gel. Do they then risk throwing that out again with a bloke who hasn't played with several of these other new guys?
If he can ruck, he takes Zach Smith's spot. If
you don't like Zach Smith.
My preference is... Have you seen his numbers in the last 2 weeks?
You've got less regard for Ruckman than Mick Malthouse.
And Grant Thomas.
That is true.
Come on, next.
You mentioned the Ox earlier, Rohan. Last week he...
The Ox
gave
is slow, but the earth
is slow,
patient.
That's right. Yeah, David Schwartz. He gave a pep talk to the Demons last week. And one man he didn't seem to overly enjoy it was Jesse Hogan. As we know, earlier in the season, Schwartz had a crack at Hogan for his poor kicking during the NAB Cup. Jesse didn't take that too well, and during this pep talk it sort of said that Jesse didn't really sort of focus in on David too much, and afterwards wasn't that keen on saying hello to him. So while a few of his teammates were able to. So there's a bit of talk that maybe Jesse just needs to mature a little in the way he sort of handles criticism in this caper.
Yeah, well, I'm not going to say stop reading the media, Jesse, because we thrive on it, but...
New nickname for Jesse Hogan.
What's that?
Oh, he's got to be Colonel Clink now.
What?
A new nickname for Schwartz, sorry, is Colonel Clink.
Why?
Constantly vexed by Hogan. Hogan!
Hogan!
Levi Casbolt, who we've said had a great weekend over the Pies. Well, he's out of contract this year. His management's not going to open talks until later in the season, but I reckon he could be in for a decent deal. As we know, Brendan Bolton wants players who can kick. That was the model the Hawks have used so successfully, and Brendan's from there, obviously. They're persisting with Levi at this stage, and hopefully his kicking inside 50 can improve. Those close to Levi are still disappointed that Sav Rocker wasn't retained. He did some good work with him last year.
Well,
his kicking percentage last
there?
Year was 67%. It's dropped down to 46. Sav Rocker, I was told, was on about $5,000 at the Blues. He wanted a little bit more, and the deal just couldn't be done, so Sav was out the door.
Geez, not the Carlton Football Club of old, clearly.
Would they take... as a goal-kicking coach for Levi Casbolt, are they willing to put money into it, or is that just something that they've...
Well, Brendan said at the weekend he's been kicking his leg off. That's how much kicking he's been done, so...
Well, he's not going to kick too well with one leg, is he?
No, that's true.
Do they need
to go left foot.
Do they need to publicly come out and say that part of our work on Levi Casbolt to re-sign him is we're going to get a good kicking coach for him? Because... it seems as though he needs to be sort of held by the hand through his career at kicking a goal.
Do you think, the other thing holding him back.
Do you think Fremantle might come in with a big offer for another key forward? Yeah,
possibly 10 years.
They could use someone at the moment.
Yeah. Gold Coast, more forward, Brandon Matera has struggled for a game this year. There's several clubs interested in him. We spoke last week about Paddy Ryder struggling to deal with his suspension. Well, Jake Carlisle's another guy obviously suspended this year. He was with St Kilda. He's said to be doing really well, though. He's training hard. He's working 3 days a week in construction. His fitness is good. He has a weekly debrief with his manager. He's really looking forward to getting back in September.
How's the construction going to help his football, do you think?
Well, it takes his mind off the suspension, obviously, doesn't it? He's able to focus on other things. Keeps him fit. It's tough work as well.
Come on, I've opened the door for you there. Analogies between football and building?
No, there are no analogies. You're from working wood, class.
Hard hat.
You're working class stock. I thought you would have thought it's the perfect way for a footballer to occupy themselves.
I always preferred the idea of running a pub or...
No.
Teaching.
Yeah. That's,
I'm not working class stock. I'm the ultimate Chardonnay socialist, mate. I live in East Malvern.
You know, I think Carlisle's seriously... had a lot of growing up to do and probably done a bit of it on the building sites. I'll tell you what, I know football clubs are places that dickheads don't do well in, but so are building sites. It's a team effort there and he's going to have to carry his, you know, do his work, seriously.
They'll keep him honest.
And just a quick one, the debate all week's about coaches and who's under the most pressure, Rodney Eade, Ross Lyon, Nathan Buckley or Damien Hardwick. I think you touched on this yesterday, Rohan. How would you list those four in terms of who's under... the pump at this stage?
Well, that's a great irony of it. Yeah. They're all pretty much underperforming, and yet three of them have had recent contract extensions. And my understanding is Rodney Eade, also, he's the fourth, is under no pressure whatsoever in terms of his future coaching there. Yeah. So I think in terms of reputation, I actually think it's Ross Lyon. Now, we know his record is proven, but he's never had a bigger challenge than having to remake this Fremantle side and actually, I think, change his coaching philosophy. Mm. Even at the moment, like Freo are putting in a few of these young kids, but they're dropping them just as quickly. And that was his story at St Kilda. He'd play the kids very sparingly, not give them enough time to get any continuity and drop them again. Now, that can't go on after this season at Freo because clearly there's going to be a changing of the guard. So, look, I'm not saying he's incapable of doing it, but I really think Ross, at the end of this year, is going to have to basically rethink the way he goes about it.
And some of those young Saints at the time still haven't forgotten how they were sort of allegedly treated during that era. So.
Yeah, Tom Lynch and Reece Stanley haven't forgotten.
Yep.
So it's a great test for him.
Yep.
All right. Look, thanks for that. We'll let you get back to your socialise. I saw Waleed Ali. He's a former Channel 31 star, Waleed Ali, by the way. So you can catch up with him
for
lunch.
For us yet.
Work on your next TV gig.
Did he win? He won the Gold Logie, didn't he?
Waleed Ali. Mm. You're pretending you don't know that, aren't you?
No, but he did win it.
He did.
Okay.
And?
I don't know. I'm surprised.
Oh, no, we're not going there. I love Waleed. I reckon he's great value.
I'm surprised Peter Hellyer didn't win it. It's because the two other panellists have won it.
I was surprised Alf Stewart didn't win it for Ray Maher, isn't it? Alf Stewart, I mean, he's been the backbone of Home and Away for three decades now.
He might have been the bloke that clipped Phillips's brother.
Flaming mongrels. You'll be back for the credibility letter, you flaming mongrel. Let's get to another break. When we return, we've got a star, a car, and if Finey remembered to fill up this week, we'll go far in our weekly dose of footy nostalgia.
They introduced the tequila shot clock at the Logies last night. Warney beat one of the housewives. What do you reckon?
We did have a discussion about that after the game. He thinks he always had the journey in him.
Thanks for joining us on Footyology. And today we catch up with a former Hawthorn great, a key member of their incredible run of success in the 1980s. And the good news is his hair's still as lustrous as ever. Get ready for Stars in Cars.
Gary Ayres, how are you?
Yeah, I'm well, Finey. How are you?
Shut the back window because it's a bit chilly. Again, perfect Waverley. Rohan, do you have memories of Waverley being cold and hard to get out of the car park?
Yeah, pretty much. And wet and traipsing across a whole lot of mud to get to your car and not finding your car and then queuing up for 2 hours to get out of here. So all we're missing is the mud, really, Gary. But it was a pretty, I mean, more a home to you in the twilight of your career, I guess, but always a pretty happy hunting ground for the Hawks, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was, Rohan. And obviously the games that were played certainly during the
Escort Cup games and Panasonic Cup games, and they were generally about the middle of the year, and it was wet and foggy, and it was really difficult, obviously, because of the way the ground surface was. But then by the end of my time, they certainly got the ground surface right, and it became a pretty good ground. And as we well know, and history will say, we played the 1991 Premiership / Grand Final out here. So it's has got some really good memories, and you see what the mighty Fighting Hawks are doing now. So it's always nice to come out.
When did Hawthorn play? Was it Claremont in that?
Oh, and the sprinklers
game
came on.
Yeah,
that was
79.
One of the memories. We were just basically standing out in the middle of the oval, and of course Claremont were pretty keen to do well, and I think even maybe the Cracker Brothers might have been playing as well from memory. And next thing, we're standing there in a slight stop in play, and next thing the sprinklers came on. So not only was it raining from down below, but also too generally rained up above.
Now, like a lot of those Hawthorn players that went on and played in that great era, you did a fair apprenticeship, didn't you? I think you started, what, 78 or something?
Yeah, that's right. Rowan started in 1978. I came down a little bit later, actually, in the season, because I had actually completed the 1977-78 pre-season, and they were going through the list at certain times and reassessing if you should stay on or not. And it came to a point just before the season started that they thought I could play in the under-19s for Hawthorn. Well, I'd already come from Warrigal as a 16, 17-year-old playing senior footy, and my father thought that that would be a backward step, because you're already playing against men, and if you want to improve your footy, that's what you should do. So I end up going back to my local club, Warrigal, and end up playing the first half a dozen or so games back at Warrigal, and then was invited down for a game actually out of Waverley against Richmond Reserves, because they thought that'd be handy coming from Warrigal. It wouldn't be as far as you to travel. But I end up only having to play six reserve games before I got a taste of senior footy out at the Witten Oval. So I was probably fairly lucky in that regard. But I certainly found out that football at this level can be a great leveller. I made my debut against Footscray, kicked three goals, and got picked the next week against Richmond at Princes Park, got two possessions, got dropped for the rest of the year.
Jeez, that's pretty tough, three goals after a debut.
Amazing view. I mean, I've just caught a glimpse of the grandstand there, the Waverley grandstand. This is Mervac Homes, this giant sort of, you'd call it...
Estate.
Estate, that's exactly what I'm looking for. Amazing, amazing setup, given that this is... used to be considered what we called it, Arctic Park.
Arctic Park. It's funny though,
the
isn't
far
it?
Ends of the universe.
By the time they got rid of it as a venue, everyone was getting really sentimental about it, weren't they?
You're right. And who knows, if we had been able to possibly get a train line around maybe Wheelers Hill or somewhere a bit closer, it certainly might have been able to actually have a little bit more longevity.
Yeah. Certainly beats taking two buses to get here and waiting in the car park for an hour and a half to get out.
It was always great just to sort of cut across. It was always great. Yep. I knew the local publican when I was playing junior footy, and he used to take us for a cannery, him and his son and myself and a couple of other local lads, and we'd go for a cannery in Beaconsfield and then come down here and be always wanting, as young kids did, to try and get on the ground first to kick the footy when the final siren went. And then we'd always go to the KFC on Police Road there and get a bucket of chicken and gnaw on that on the way back to Druid and Warrigal.
That was Paul Van Der's pre-game ritual. with a few bundies.
And the snags as well on a Tuesday, Thursday night.
Oh, wasn't that great? See, finally, the footy media now, they don't know what they're missing. Back in the old Glen Ferry days, old Bobby Yeoman.
Yes.
And he'd have his... His apron on with the plastic fake breasts on it. They were great days.
And his white singlet and the cigarette hanging out while he's cooking the drumsticks and the sausages and the chips in that deep fryer. I think one day someone, when they cleaned it out after however many years, found a couple of pairs of old footy boots in there, I think.
Do you reckon, Gary, it sort of underlines how good a coach Clarkson is and the value of team now? Because I've got to be honest, pound for pound, if I look at the best side that you were part of, and I reckon probably 88 was maybe the peak for you guys versus these guys, I reckon your mob had it all over them for individual talent.
Yeah, and I think that's right too, and I guess you're a little bit biased because you played through that era, and we certainly batted unbelievably deep in relation to personnel that played, and there's no doubt that if we look at what Alan Jeans did when he came to Hawthorn, in 1981. He had an emerging group of young players. He was there for 10 years. Alan Joyce stepped in once through the 80s, and obviously 88, as you said, was just a powerhouse team. And I think we only lost six games in 2 years,
yeah,
in 88,
right.
89.
Yeah.
While still obviously, you know, playing that sort of powerful ground of footy. And then when Alistair Clarkson came to Hawthorn, it was a case of, I would have thought, we need a coach who's going to be here for a long, long time.
Yeah.
And I think that's one important ingredient, is the stability that he's been able to have and bring and, I guess, keep at the football club. There's been very little change at the top. Obviously, there's, you know, Jeff Kennett came and went, and of course Newbold came and went, and but you think about head office, and
yeah,
Alistair has been able to assemble a group of people that are very talented, and no doubt Alistair blossomed as a coach and is going to go down as one of the greatest of all time.
Rohan, do you know who came up with Conan?
Well, I'm sure Gary does, but I think it was something to do with the hair, wasn't it, Gary?
Well, it's actually, that's not necessarily the case, Rohan. It would certainly be a comparison that Louis Richards ended up making a little bit later on, but it was very mild, I guess, really, because what we used to do as players, you'd be certainly hanging around in the change rooms before training, and we actually would always have a bit of banter about who did what and who was out on Saturday night and who watched what show and what movie. Anyway, we're down at Scotch College, and anyway, Russell Green, always being the prankster that he was, and of course he came up with, oh, did anyone see Arnold Schwarzenegger's movie last night? And Rod Lester Smith was standing alongside him, and Snuffy goes, yeah, I saw it, Russ. And he goes, yeah, what about that Conan the Barbarian? Anyway, I just happened to be walking past, and of course he goes, there's Conan the Barbarian. So from that point on at training, if I ran past for a hand pass or I went to kick or Russell Green was in that vicinity and Fly Morris and Snuffy, it would be Conan or Coey or Co. So that was how lame brain it actually was, because apparently the two boys had watched Conan the Barbarian on TV.
Now, Gary, a key part of this segment, of course, is we get everyone who is invited on to players a favourite song and usually a reason for it. Yours is definitely the most appropriate choice, and everyone hearing kick in now would recognise, of course, the strains of Jimmy Barnes, No Second Prize. Well, the Hawks never knew any bloody second prize, did they?
No, we certainly didn't want to be part of it, because it meant that there was a bit of failure associated with it, right? So, no second prize, and we had a few clips one day that we played before a big game and grand final, and certainly we were very, very happy that that day we didn't actually get any second prize.
This is very 80s too, isn't it? In fact, why didn't they get Barnsley to do this grand final out here rather than bloody Angry?
Money, mate.
Yeah.
Barnsley, I reckon you could have got Angry.
You reckon Angry paid them?
I reckon Angry might have been... Angry in the Batmobile would have been cheaper than Barnsley in any other normal form of transport, surely.
And possibly too, because Angry was bald and Jimmy Barnes would have had the old mullet back in those days, which we're all obviously famous for. So, but no, it was always a thing that the boys would be very happy about. They would have the players rage, and these songs would be blasting through the so-called, I guess, miming was a big thing back in those days, that the players rages, and we also think we'd want to be part of it.
You have done. Hey, I'll tell you one thing we've got to mention as well. I've become a fan of the Borough. Two premierships?
One, actually. We probably should have had two.
Second, next one this year. Count of Mighty Borough.
So. No, that'd be just a great finish to a year that started off pretty well, Finey. So look forward to it.
So, Gaz, that's it. We're back at Waverley.
Yeah, very good.
No Batmobiles.
No, appreciate it. And
great to have you on.
Thanks very much for your interest in an old-timer.
Great Hawthorn era, Gary, and a great one now. I just hope this one ends at some stage so a few other teams can get a go. Yeah.
Gary is a real star in the car.
Cheers, Gary.
Thanks, Rohan. Thank you.
Welcome back to Footyology. You've got the questions, we think we've got the answers. And if we haven't, we'll at least make it sound like we do. It's time to touch base with the Twitterverse on Keyboard Q&A. Well, great segment this, Finey. I'll ask it again. How are you going on Twitter?
Slow week.
Yeah? Not much out there?
I had such an enormous opportunity. Hand to heart, true story. I was at the Orong Hotel on Thursday afternoon, just minding my business and making sure casino greyhounds had a following. And a bloke who I know at the pub gets fronted by a guy I didn't know, and the guy says, "Are you betting on the footy?" He goes, "Yeah, I'm backing the Hawks to beat Richmond." He goes, "Careful, Mitchell's not playing." The guy goes, "How do you know?" He goes, "I'm Kieran Lovell's uncle. They're flying the family because he's playing tonight and Mitchell's out." And it happened at midday. I could have tweeted that and been a hero. But I thought, you don't tweet stuff you hear in the pub. So now I'm gun shy.
Well, also, you can't now, if you're a member of the footy media, do engage in any betting practices.
I didn't want to bet, but this was 7 hours before the game. I could have had the scoop and told the world that Mitchell wasn't playing.
That's good. I had some great blues on the weekend on Twitter too, but I'll
but that's
take
your,
it.
That's your want.
That is my sort of modus operandi. Okay, so we've asked for your questions and they've come in floods this week, and we're going to start with... I'm sorry, apologies to whoever you are, but my eyesight is going. I'm going to need glasses.
Kyle Volotakis.
Thank you. You can do the names. He who asks, how much of Port's mediocre season to date can we attribute to Ryder's and Lobie's absence? That's a very good question. Ryder, I don't know about Ryder. I think Monfries has been a bigger loss to them. The two of them obviously suspended by the Court of Arbitration for Sport, but... Lobie, he was sort of left one out, and he's not there now.
They dropped him and he got injured, so they've really not had him access to him for a week.
Yeah. So how are they going, do you think, in the big man department?
They dropped Dougal Howard. They went with no ruckman. It works for the Bulldogs. It can work. I mean, they were up against...
Dougal Howard. That sounds uncomfortably like Doogie Howser, doesn't it? Do you ever watch that show?
I didn't like the premise.
Boy doctor.
Yeah, I mean, my mother was on my case to be an adult doctor.
Really?
The fact that there was a TV show about...
She wanted you to be like Doogie.
She's a Jewish mother. She wanted me to be a doctor. The fact that there was a TV show that she didn't know was not real, that had a doctor at 13, set the bar so ridiculously high, it just ruined my childhood.
Sorry for completely derailing that question.
Stephen Martin sort of... He didn't tear them apart, but he got a lot of it. Mm. They might go the Bulldogs route and just get tall guys to fill the breach. Lobie wasn't going that well.
Well, Westhoff, Dixon can sort of fill... It wasn't that great...
Westhoff, Dixon, they'll do the work.
Wasn't that great footage on the weekend too after Dixon kicked a goal and Westhoff's got his arm around him, two blokes with the beards. It was like a pan down Brunswick Street on a Sunday afternoon.
Or Rip and Lee.
Okay, well, I'm talking drivel today, so let's get on with it. Now, is that... Tell me who it is. Kurt?
The only other option's unmentionable. No. It's Kurt.
It is Kurt. Who asks, would anyone have cared if Wood, as in Mason Wood, had pretended to be preparing himself instead of standing there? Talking, of course, about the controversial shot clock and the end of that St Kilda North Melbourne game. No, I didn't care, actually... that he did what he did knowing that there was 30 seconds on the shot clock. It's all a bit of a storm and a teacup for me.
It's an absolute storm and a teacup because they know how long there is to go in the game. 40 seconds to go, he would have been told by fans and by his trainer. He was going to use the 30 seconds whether it was on the clock.
Well, he was.
Or not.
I think there is actually footage of the runner thereabouts telling him how long to go.
Anyway, so. I've had a disaster with it, not because St Kilda lost the game, but in talking about it on the weekend, I got Mason Wood and Mason Cox mixed up, and I got their names mixed up, and it was just an embarrassment for everybody involved.
I always want to say Things of Mason Wood. Remember that band, Things of Stone and Wood?
Yeah, well, there are two Masons playing, and don't mix their names up, because they're not interchangeable.
No, I won't. Not when that other surname's involved. Okay, next tweet, please, Mastro.
From James Wharf.
From James Wharf, who asks, what do you think of Juddy's call, that as in Chris Judd, Juddy's call last night on another footy show we won't name, but the one that where they're always arguing with each other and going, I want you to apologise. Anyway, Juddy's call last night that the Bulldogs look to recruit Travis Cloke. Interesting call, and if I was them, I wouldn't be having a bar of it. He's in trouble. They've got Tom Boyd, who's probably got about 10 years ahead of him. And the forward line seemed to function pretty well on the weekend.
Ba-bow, bad suggestion.
Why would you suggest that, Juddy?
They were on the Cloke case 2 or 3 years ago. It made sense. Doesn't make any sense anymore. Travis Cloke as a commodity in football has limited value. It's a team that might need a third option up forward for a tall. I don't think teams are going that route. Just, he's going to have to stick it out of Collingwood or go to Richmond and then go back to Collingwood and back to Richmond and just be like his father.
The game's gone past him a little bit, I think. You know why Juddy asked that question, don't you? So next week, Hutchie can go, when are you going to apologise for that ridiculous question about Travis Cloke? That's how it works. Not like here at Footyology. Next tweet, please, Mastro. And it is from...
Damo Navy.
Who asks, given the form of the large Melbourne clubs, sorry, should, for example, Carlton Collingwood still play twice a year? Well, actually, they're not locked into that now. I think Carlton Essendon probably only played once last year from memory. I don't think all those blockbusters are locked in. Carlton Collingwood has been. Carlton Richmond, I think, only played once.
Collingwood Essendon this year?
Is that their only meeting? Yeah. Well, I couldn't agree more. I mean, we've got to move past that in two ways. One, it's not a Victorian competition anymore, so they don't get right to have big drawing games just because they're established clubs. But secondly, we need as many shackles taken off the fixturing as possible.
Just on fixturing, you know, we've had this discussion about including potentially Good Friday as another marquee game, and they're looking for different marquee setups right throughout the year. Did you hear the one going the other way? Suggestions that no football be played on Mother's Day. Because people don't... Well, people don't turn up in droves on Mother's Day, and it's a day for mothers. It's not actually a day for mothers. It's a day that a greeting card company in America designated to increase their sales. As you know, every day is Mother's Day, Rohan.
Well, one of the... yeah, exactly. I went and saw my... Hi, Mum. Remember the Mother's Day Massacre, of course, back in 1991 when Richmond smashed Collingwood.
I thought you were talking about the...
Someone just laughed there. It was a metaphorical Mother's Day Massacre. It wasn't a real thing.
I thought you were referring to the unfortunate goings-on in a Chicago...
No.
Garage.
No, I wasn't. I was talking about the day Jeff Hogg kicked 10 goals for Richmond against Collingwood, a small example of my tiny, stupid train-spotting mind. OK, we're going to have one more tweet quickly... Very quickly, and it's from Finey.
What's more... Oh, sorry, it's Saint Lion.
Go on, you read it out.
What's more important, Rohan _ Connolly, for the Freo rebuild, acquiring Hogan or keeping Lachie Neale?
That's a good question. Gee, well, I tell you what, Lachie Neale, I know people say, oh, Hogan, you know, Hogan is big key forward and kicks lots of goals, but Lachie Neale's a... quality midfielder, and their midfield is getting
old.
Is
he quality midfielder?
Oh, yeah.
Quality ball getter.
What's the weak part of his game?
His disposal.
Yeah, but I mean, in the context of their midfield, you know, they're all getting old, they're not overly endowed with pace. He's got to be a key plank of it. And he's one of the few players who've been there 4 or 5 years who have really continued to grow. I mean, you look beyond that veteran class and Fife. Who are the guys who have really continued to get better for them?
Lachie Neale, of course, is one of them. The other one would be probably nobody. Look, they've maybe, just maybe, a couple of their younger players can come on. A Crozier, certainly not Tabiner, he just doesn't get the ball. But it's an interesting question, but they're not interconnected situations. These are unrelated matters because one's a key forward, one's a midfielder. They need to keep Neale and get Hogan.
But just another part of the coaching conundrum for Ross Lyon. Mm. Another break now. When we return, forget all about the AFL ladder. It's Finey, me and little old JP who'll decide whether your team has cred or is crud.
Damien, this is an awkward question. You took Ty Vickery off 5 hours ago. He's still sitting on the bench. Should someone tell him to come in and have a shower?
Oh, it's what's done's done. I know what you're saying, but the situation is we shouldn't have been in that situation anyway.
Respect, regard, repute. Many aspire to it, few can earn it. Sure, teams can win games of football, but are they good enough to climb the dizzy heights of the Footyology credibility ladder? Well, back again, JP. How's Waleed going?
He's hanging in there.
Oh, good, OK. A bit hungover, obviously. Now, incredible news here, Finey, and JP made an executive decision. We couldn't get our act together early enough this week. So JP actually went ahead, came up with his own version of the credibility ladder, and now we're going to pick holes right through it.
I'm sure you will.
So let's take us from the top. What do you have on top?
Well, I've gone with GWS this week. Obviously, a big win over in Fremantle. There was a theory that perhaps they could struggle over there coming off a big win against Hawthorn, but they showed a lot of maturity. Freo threw everything at them, and they were able to hang on.
Yeah, it was a good win in Perth. Geez, those white jumpers look ordinary, don't they? Particularly when they're wearing the long sleeves. Next, I'm going to throw in a Finey will like this one. I'm going to throw in one out of left field here. Contender, not for top maybe, but second, the Saints. Fantastic performance. Almost knocked off the undefeated Kangaroos. Couple of, you know, questionable, the ruck free kick against Tom Hickey, a bit questionable.
Not questionable at all. Absolutely free every
really?
Day of the week. Look, I umpire, and it's a simple, that is a really easy free to give. As soon as he did it, you can't look at a ruckman, fend off, and then go for it. It's sort of the almost pin-up textbook version of shepherding in the ruck as we have today. You might not like the rule, but it was perfectly administered.
Well, that aside, what did you think of their performance?
Really good to get back in the game against North. I don't have them anywhere near that high. I thought North were a bit disappointing. They look pretty mortal to me, North Melbourne. Nothing all that special. As Jared Waite had an okay game but didn't tear it apart. And St Kilda actually, they just, like in the game against GWS and Bulldogs at the same ground, except this time they did click into gear, they're not playing it he had well. They're not playing good movement football for four quarters there, except against Melbourne. I'm more confident against West Coast next week. I thought they were very good, not super, in that loss.
Okay.
Just one on the Mother's Day argument you just had before. I think there is merit in not having games on Mother's Day, to be honest.
Then how about Father's Day?
The Saints wanted about 30,000 to get to the game. There was only like 27 in the end, and the crowd in Adelaide wasn't that great either.
Sorry, so is this a new segment or the credibility ladder?
Just wanted to have my say.
You've just lost your
just
credibility.
Just wanted to have my say.
Yeah, get on with it. So we're GWS first, St Kilda second. Who'd you have third and fourth?
I think Carlton deserves some merit, don't they? Three wins in a row.
Yeah, go on. Yep.
Yeah, they're good.
Not many people would have tipped three in a row, that's for sure. The Pies, you know, you'd think they still had a stronger list than Carlton at the weekend, but the Blues were able to get the job done.
Okay. Hawks, what do we think of their win?
Well, it was the first time an Alistair Clarkson coach team had not had either one of Roughhead, Mitchell or Hodge. So take that into account. James Frawley was not playing either. Richmond played okay, yet in that last quarter they kicked 9-3 and stormed over the Tigers and just said to everyone, we're still here, we're still the champions.
Yeah, but Richmond didn't have their best defender, and we conceded a couple of weeks ago they got the worst defence in the league with him, so they met them without their captain and their best defender to temper that a bit.
Yep. I'm slightly concerned at how much work you've put into this. Okay, so our top four, if we can get up on the ladder, is GWS, St Kilda, Hawthorn, Carlton. Okay, we're going to rip through the middle bit now. Now, none of this is me and Finey's doing. This is all John Pierik, so blame him if you're not happy with it. Melbourne next, Geelong, followed by Western Bulldogs. I reckon you got them too low, JP. I reckon that was a really good win over Adelaide, who I rate very highly. North Melbourne next. Finey might be right. Not quite on their game. Sydney next. You know, routine win over a pretty ordinary side.
I liked Sydney's win. Yeah. Not for the credibility ladder, but gee, that Franklin forward line is starting to operate really well. Callum Sinclair missed a few goals. I'm just like, in the context of what's coming up for Sydney, that was a really encouraging setup. Their team looks, I think they're the best team in the competition.
Okay, we're going to fly through this last bit, so we'll just stick it up there. Adelaide after Port Adelaide, Gold Coast, Richmond, getting used to them being down there. And then the bottom five in
this
order. We've got, here are the contenders. Collingwood, Essendon, Brisbane, West Coast, Fremantle.
Well, obviously we'll put Collingwood last.
No, we're not.
Most fun.
No, JP, blame him.
Sorry. He's got. Went for the Dockers last. It's haven't won a game yet. We're a chance at the weekend.
I nearly knocked over GWS.
True, but they still think get the job done.
But they got taken out in the end. Pretty comfortable.
Okay, and then you've got West Coast
second last. Well, West Coast can't get the job done in Melbourne, can they?
They can't, and I'm not sure how many people in Perth are watching us, so get stuffed, people. No, I'm just kidding. West Coast and Fremantle on the bottom. My parents are from Perth. Why did I say that? And just above them, Brisbane, Essendon, Collingwood. Brisbane just can't fire. They can't ever back up a decent performance, can they?
Two in a row.
Really disappointing. Essendon next, about what do you expect? And the Pies, they're in an enormous hole. Of course, hopefully we'll have Maguire into the 22 this week because he fits in with their game plan.
Ruck Rover? Or?
I don't know. Where would you play, Eddie?
Half forward?
What position?
In the centre.
In the centre?
Yeah.
Of the universe. Okay, so there's a credibility ladder for this week. Thanks, JP. What's on the agenda tonight?
Some sleep.
Some sleep. Yeah, you'll need it. You'll need it. Geez, you give it a nudge. You give it a... He hits it really hard. I know he doesn't look like it. No, I'm just...
His light beers are pretty...
No.
He's, up.
He's very, very clean cut. Thanks for joining us. We'll see you again next week. Time for our final break now. When we return, have some earmuffs ready.
Nathan, we know that there's been some disharmony in the group about where to book your end of season trip in September. Some want to go to Bali, some want to go to Thailand, you guys just want to go to country Victoria. How's it affected the group?
Yeah, we've had open discussions about it at coaching level and with the players.
Welcome back. How does it happen? You're watching a loss or not giving a toss? Ready to burst? That umpire's the worst. A hard-earned rage needs a long, cold rant. And the best rant is ours, right now, in the Footyology Rant Off.
We're not on.
Sorry, you were saying?
It was like the VB ad.
It was. John Mellion.
Yeah, matter of fact... I think I'm first now.
You are. You're first up this week. I'm going to count you in properly like you never do for me. Three.
No, that's wrong. You start at 30.
Do you want me to count in from 30?
No,
that's not
really.
Great TV. 3, 2, 1, rant!
The reason I wanted you to count from 30 is I want to talk about the shot clock. The shot clock fiasco at Etihad Stadium was really not that much of a fiasco. It was better. The shot clock was better than the shit clock, which of course was the last clock used on the scoreboard at Waverley. The neglect and the lack of light bulbs made it undecipherable. Don't worry about the shot clock on the scoreboard at Etihad. Worry about this. We've been told that the shot clock will appear at some grounds, but not all grounds. Did I not rant last week about the lack of consistency with the administration of the goal review system? And now we have an ad hoc shot clock. Am I knocking my head against a paper wall? I move that and that's a paper wall. Look, it's unacceptable, AFL. It's at every ground or no ground. Why don't you make it policy? Let's have some grounds with boundary markings, some not. Some grounds with car parks, some not. Some grounds with goalposts, some not. How about some grounds without any AFL administrators? It's not acceptable. Consistency, people. We're consistent. We do the rant last on the program every week. People know what to expect. What new surprises from the AFL next week? I don't even wish to venture a thought as to what we will have at some grounds and not others in the AFL. Watch this space.
Very good. That's the angriest I've seen you so far.
Well, I moved the screen. That didn't work.
You wanted your head to go through it, didn't
yeah,
you?
Yeah, I mean, paper. I can see why the...
Isn't that where our clairvoyant was from last week? Or the masseuse?
I don't know. The only time I've seen screens like that was were, you know, people that come out from screens like that, I like.
No, we're not going there. Okay, count me in, please.
3, 2, 1.
Umpires. They're the scourge of football, if you listen to the hordes after Saturday night's Bulldogs-Adelaide game. They're the single biggest cause of anxiety, depression and Australia's current account deficit. One of them might even have been hiding out on that grassy knoll in Dallas in 1963. Forgetting the back, holding the ball, umpiring is apparently now a mathematical equation. And this was a massive conspiracy. Well, it was if you ask Adelaide's official ambassador, Chris Kennedy. You know, that blowhard is always banging on about lefties and ABC bias and whose TV show is watched by two men and a dog. Oh, it's okay, Chris, not that dog. Now Kenny reckons Crows fans should boycott games against Victorian teams. Kenny's such a bellend, he makes the Crows' other ambassador, Christopher Pine, look like a ripping bloke. But the biggest outrage in this whole latest umpiring kerfuffle is the shock revelation that Troy Pennell on Saturday night gave Jake Stringer a tap on the bum as he ran past. Well, bugger me with a fish fork. If that doesn't prove the whole thing is a setup. Seriously, where were these people in the 1980s? That umpire Peter Cameron was so friendly with the players, he didn't just give them a pat on the arse, he'd have his tongue halfway down their throats. You know that famous scene out of Last Tango in Paris? That wasn't really Marlon Brando and Maria Schneider getting it on. It was Peter Cameron and Dipper during that all-in brawl in the 1985 Grand Final. Look, umpires are human. Okay, so they look a bit pasty and collect stamps, but they're not part of some organised crime syndicate. And if they can piss the likes of Chris Kenny off, I say they're good for football.
Good boys standing up for us umpires.
Yeah.
I've got a cough again. Pardon me.
That did. That went very well. As a few people coughing at home, I think, after that.
No, that was excellent. I mean, honestly, it's not a numbers game, and a touch on the arse is not a bad thing. It's not terrible.
No, we're all going to give each other one as soon as we finish this show. That's it for this week.
Not all.
No, not you. I know.
We want to vote, don't we?
Oh, yeah, how are we voting?
Quick. Very simple this week. Look, the voting system didn't work last week. We used a clairvoyant to try and read the minds of our viewers, and she got her wires crossed, and we got no votes. We got a lot of bloody advice, but no votes. This week, we thought we'd make it more global so it could be seen from outer space. Crop circles are easy to do, and so are crop rocos and finies. You need a large property. The Kidmans would be good. They're not selling to the Chinese. The government said no. Find a lot of wheat. You'd rake in the names, Roco and Finey. Make it big, because the mere citation is on board. The Soviets are in. And hopefully we'll get the Americans, and apparently the Indians send up a satellite as well, and they'll look for it too. So I think we're going to get plenty of votes.
This one better work or I'm taking over the voting. Thanks for joining us again at Footyology. Hope you've had fun. We're on every Tuesday at 12 p.m. on YouTube or 7:30 p.m. on Channel 31. And remember, Finey, as Bob Dylan asked so memorably, how many roads must a man walk down before you call him a man? How many seas must a white dove sail before she sleeps in the sand? The answer, my friend, is easy to see. The answer is Footyology. See you next week.